Hi, Julie Jones from SSB Performance, Smarter, Stronger, Better Mindset Training. Here with this week's Mindset Made Simple Tip of the Week, brought to you by Game Day Sportswear. This week, we're talking about the words we use and how we can use these words to improve our performance. I'm building a course called The Art of Coach Communication for next semester. And in reading all of the research and getting this course together, it's been fascinating. And I can't wait to share this information with the future coaches that are in my class next semester. But before then, and before this material gets set into my syllabus, I thought I would share a little bit with you about how this communication tool that I'm about to teach and research go together to help the mental game. Now, I'm not teaching a mental performance course, I'm teaching a communications course, but it has everything to do with the mental game. And we're going to tie some of this research into my favorite mental performance tool, mental rehearsal. If we're not using mental rehearsal in our lives, we are selling ourselves short. Think about it. How often do you rehearse things? How often do you see things without using your eyes? I bet it happens a lot more than you pay attention to in your everyday life. As we've discussed in the past, our brain sees images constructed by our language, constructed by our experiences. And the words we use to build these images really matters. As Trevor Moad says, words are tools. They predict and perpetuate our performance. We know that the words we use matter in our own head when we're talking to ourselves. So it should come as no surprise that these words matter when we're instructing or we're talking about what we want to do as well. And it all boils down to what these words that we use direct our focus toward. What are we focusing on as we're trying to do whatever it is that we're trying to accomplish? When we use words, and research has shown this time and time again, when we use words, when we're thinking about what to do, or when we're instructing someone to do a skill, when we use words that focus toward an external cue, our performance significantly increases. An external cue, in this case, means taking our focus off of what our body is doing and placing it on the environment around us. Dr. Gabrielle Wolf, an expert in motor learning, highlights that external focus enhances motor performance and learning. When coaches instruct athletes to focus on desired outcomes using vivid words that create vivid images, such as picturing the perfect golf ball, the golf swing, or an ideal stride length, they help athletes internalize the correct technique. An example of an internal cue, which is what Dr. Wolf says that we should try to avoid, would be something like this. Focus on triple extension through your ankles, your knees, and your hips. And I've said that a million times, repeating what we did in the weight room from our strength coaches or whomever we were working with. But that, thinking about our ankles, our knees, our hips, what this does is it gets us to think about our body. And when we think about our body automatically in sort of pulls in other muscles to other than the joints and the muscles that we really need to do this. It's almost like a counterproductive act. They did a study on the speed of a barbell curl. And when the cue was, explode or yank the bar up, and maybe yank isn't the right word, instead of think about contracting your biceps. The speed of the bar was so much faster with the external cue because when the internal cue got us thinking about what's going on in our body, all of a sudden the triceps came in, which then actually slows the bar down. There's a whole bunch of technical stuff that goes on with that, but you can get the picture of this. When someone says explode off the ground, you're not thinking about what your ankle has to do and what your knee has to do, just like you don't think about walking down the steps and what your knees are doing when you're walking down the steps. If you did that, you'd probably fall down the steps. But the bottom line is that when we are thinking about an external cue would be something like this. Focus on driving up from the ground and as explosively as possible. So are we going to look at, think about your ankles, your knees, your hips, and thrust up, or focus on exploding up from the ground? What do you see differently there? What do you feel differently there? What do you hear differently? How does that incorporate into your muscular and motor learning movements that help you work better. Dr. Wolf and others' work repeatedly says that when we can see and feel the result of movement, we perform it better. The words we use when describing an external cue are less technical in this case, but they help us avoid what they call the zoom fallacy when we zoom our focus in on the actual movements and the movement errors. And you can see this happening because we're always looking for what went wrong. But when we're in this mode of zoom fallacy or zoomed in on internal cues, meaning what is my body supposed to do it right at this moment, because we get so technical with it, we perform worse because we're too far in the weeds. And you can think about how much we get in the weeds sometimes when we're trying to do something. When we're thinking about every single mechanical step, it slows us down. It takes our attention away from the environment. And the environment is where we have to perform. It's where we have to adjust. When we're thinking about exploding, we can take in things in the observe the landscape mode. When we're thinking about step by step by step by step of movement, now we can't even observe what's going on around us, which slows us down, which makes us less responsive. And you can see how that would inversely affect our performance. If we get too close to beautiful artwork, we can't see the beauty of it. We can't see the forest or the trees, as they say. Why does this matter to our mental game? And how do this word cues or this motor learning stuff affect our mental game? Teaching those we lead to with vivid language and getting them to use that vivid language because our language becomes theirs, or teaching them to build vivid language and getting them to use these vivid external cues is going to greatly free up their brain and make their body work better. It's not a motor learning class, and motor learning books don't emphasize the mental side of the game, but this external focus is all about mental rehearsal, if you think about it. If you give cues that create an image in your athlete's mind, when they get a chance to feel, see, and live it before they perform it, then they're setting blueprints. They're working in the environment and not in their head or in every single little thing that their body's doing. Neuroscientist and author of The Organized Mind, Thinking Straight in the Age of Information Overload, Dr. Daniel Levitin emphasizes the power of imagery. He states that the brain is wired to respond to vivid, imagined experience, almost as if they're real. If you look at the picture attached to this article, you will remember possibly that I've used this before. The first line of brains is you looking at the outside of your house and counting the windows on it. This center line of brains is you imagining looking at the outside of your house, thinking of a picture of the outside of your house that's in your mind and counting the windows on it. And then the third row of brains, where there is no color, that is the difference that they found between using your mind's eye and using your eyes. Right? When we use vivid descriptive language, we're tapping into this powerful neurological mechanism that can enhance our learning and our performance. There's no significant difference in what we imagine and what we see or what we do. You're not sure you buy that? Let's talk about a little more research. Research has shown that pianists or violinists that play a specific number of measures or a certain passage, and those that actually just imagine it, both of them light up. Both light up the areas of the brain, including the same areas of the brain, including those that control movement. So if we imagine it, the motor cortex lines up. If we do it, the motor cortex lights up. There's no significant difference. Obviously, this does not take the place of physical performance or physical practice. It also doesn't make you an expert if you've never done something. But when we know what to do, this vivid language can help us enhance our performance. When we picture something, it influences our movement. In fact, Dan Wolpert in his TED Talk, The Real Reason for Brains, he explains that the primary purpose of the brain is control movement. Well, we know that the true, purpose of the brain is to keep us safe, but it often does that through movement. See a snake? Run. Maybe that's just me, but that's what we do. Our brain is meant to keep us safe. Our brain controls the movement in our body. And author Winifred Gallagher, in her explanation of attention, underscores the point by saying, what you focus on shapes your experience. When we use rich image-based language, we direct focus to a detailed meta rehearsal of the desired action. This rehearsal primes the brain for actual performance, creating kind of muscle memory in the mind that therefore, and thus for whatever you want to say, vivid images and mental rehearsal aid this control by allowing us to practice movements in our mind, redefining or refining neural pathways involved in these actions. This is important. The kind of mental practice that we do is especially beneficial when physical practice is limited by time or injury, or when we need to build a little bit of confidence. So I'm using the book called The Language of Coaching by Nick Winkelman. And in the book, he makes a list of verbs. He asks the readers to picture an image related to each word. So picture an image related to these: blast, snap, drive, punch, explode, shatter, pop, burst, and dig. What comes to your mind? You get an image of a rocket taking off, or you get an image of something punching, or somebody throwing something over, or snapping a towel. Whatever it is, when we're thinking of these big movements, we incorporate the muscles that we need without directing them step by step. And my bet is that when you think of these words, you're not thinking of get my elbow in the slot, snap my wrist down, you know, move my hand this way, keep my hands high. We're thinking about using our power and moving toward an outcome or a target. Study after study has shown that when athletes focus on bodily movements, their performance deteriorates. Connecting them to an image outside of themselves, like the path of the ball or exploding toward the ceiling, improves performance time and time again. We're rehearsing and priming the brain for the actual movement. When we use language that provides us with an image or a feeling to strive for, we free up the thought process. Internal cues and internal focus pulls more movements into the picture as we force our way into the movement instead of feeling our way through it. Add that to our tendency to give emotionally charged information preferential treatment, like images full of movement in life. These emotional significant experiences and images leave a stronger imprint in our memory and our attention. We're learning better, faster, and more efficiently. Winkelman advocates that the use of metaphors and analogies and evoke strong images and emotion enhance us. It ties us to something. It ties to our past experience. It ties to how our body moves freely. And when we use language that paints a picture, we create an emotional connection that enhances our learning and retention. Some simple ways to implement this would be these. Use descriptive language. Replace our generic instructions with specific sensory-rich descriptions. Instead of saying, run faster, say, imagine you're being pulled forward by a magnet or feel the wind rushing past you. That's why with my track guy, we talk about the lightning, the thunder, the wind, and looking out as far as we can see. Or when we talk about entering the pool, we look at a target out in the water and not thinking about driving our feet off the block, but feeling a powerful, vivid, emotionally tied image that gets us thrusting to wherever it is that we're trying to go. We can incorporate metaphors, as Winkelman says. Use metaphors that resonate emotionally and visually. For example, move like a panther, silent, focused, powerful, something like that. We can create emotional connections. Link the task to a positive emotional experience or personal goal. This can be as simple as reminding them why they started or the joy that they feel when they succeed. And then finally, of course, encourage mental rehearsal. Before performance, before practice, guide individuals through a detailed rehearsal of the task. Encourage them to see, to hear, to feel, to live every aspect of driving into the sky or lifting up something. You can make it up. Anything that goes along with your sport, there's always an external cue that you can use. As they say, a picture is worth 1,000 words. And by painting mental pictures with our words, we become thoughts, or they become thoughts. These words that we use become our athletes' words, and they become vivid and livable. That's the bottom line. This technique bridges the gap between mental preparation and physical exertion and execution, and leads to improved performance and a greater sense of achievement. and consistency and comfort and all the things that make us great. Be vivid with your language, see and feel what you want, and be externally focused, because champions are externally focused. How will you incorporate into this into your thought process this week? Research shows it makes a huge difference. If you want your team to be well-versed in mental rehearsal, reach out. I've got a three-part series that we can do with your team at any time during the season. Email me at juliej@ssbperformance.com and let's connect and get vivid language into the minds of your performers. Until next week, have a great week.